the voice of the church in New England. The views and opinions expressed by the following paid program are those of the program producers, and they do not reflect the views and opinion of Boston Praise Radio, its staff, or management. I think we all let the world know about
this happiness. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We're rejoicing and we are glad in it. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law of sin and of death. Nevertheless, we live, yet not us, the old carnal man, hallelujah, lives, but Christ Jesus lives by faith in us. His word dwells in us richly. We're blessed, we're healed, we're delivered, we're set free. Sickness cannot dwell in us. The number of our days God will fulfill, because Jesus Christ is in us and we're in him, and by faith we have the abundant life and the victory that Jesus provides. Therefore, no weapon, hallelujah, that's formed against us will ever be successful in prospering. And every tongue that rises up against us in judgment, we have the authority to condemn. This is the heritage of us, the servants of the Lord. And our righteousness is never of ourselves. Praise God, but it's of Jesus Christ. Says the Lord, greater is he who's in us than he who's in the world. Satan, who comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy, the life, and the life more abundantly. We can do all things, and only through Christ Jesus, who strengthens us. And as the redeemed of the Lord, we do decree it to be so. Greetings, my name is Minister Franklin Wendell Hobbs. You're listening to Healing Our Lands live broadcast that comes on Monday through Friday here on the Boston Praise Radio TV network via www.bostonpraiseradio.tv. There you can see us, you can hear us, engage in live instant chat conversation with us and your brothers and sisters from all across the globe. Create a username and a password and join the instant chat room via www.bostonpraiseradio.tv. We're simulcasting in New York. That is via the Sela Radio Ministry. That website's www.sela.com. And you can just, there you can see us, you can hear us, and instant chat with us as well. We're grateful to simulcast in the Bronx. You know, greetings and blessings to our brother, Bishop One, to Pastor Roy Nichols, to Brother Paul Norman, to Concourse, to NB, and to all of our family tuned in via the Sela Radio Ministry. We encourage you to check it out and engage them often. We're also simulcasting in Zion, Illinois, via the Gospel Music and Productions Network. That website is www.gmap.com. Click on channel 2. There you can hear us. You can call us live on the air. Please do call us. This is a live interactive broadcast. We want to engage you, our listeners and our viewers. That number to call is 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685. You can also contact Healing Our Land Incorporated Ministry via 617-594-9955. You can write us at 10 Ellet Street, Suite 502, Dorchester, Mass. 02122. Please visit our website, www.healingourland.org. Our foundation scripture is 2 Chronicles 7:14, that says, if my people who are called by my name would humble ourselves and pray and seek God's face and turn from our wicked ways, then God will hear from heaven, he'll forgive our sin, and he will heal our land. There's so many issues in our community that we can see need healing, and we, the body of Christ, are uniquely poised to be the light and the salt of the earth and to take dominion over every sphere of influence to be able to restore paradise as God intended. But we've got to humble ourselves, pray, conceive and birth God's immaculate conception for our lives as the part of the collective body of the Christ of Christ, that all of creation is groaning for us to assume our respective positions. The Bible says in Genesis 1:26, and God said, let us, God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit, make mankind in our image. That's his character, his personality, his attributes, with respective different gifts and callings, and let them have dominion over the earth. And so we've got a very special guest in the studio with me on today, and I'm so grateful to have had the opportunity to have been introduced to her via our beloved sister. I think the initial introduction actually came via our sister, Elder Heidi Ivy Lewis. Mm-hmm. You were a guest on her broadcast.
Yes.
And her broadcast, I believe, is called In My Father's House. Mm-hmm. And so that was her initial entree here to the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. I believe this is your second time?
It's my second time on this radio. Yes, broadcast.
On this broadcast. Yes. And so welcome.
Yes, thank you.
And she is a very dear friend of our beloved sister Patty Lee. And so we're so grateful that you would take time to be able to come on the air and be able just to educate our listeners and our viewers about this very important issue and the organization that you are the director and founder of.
Yes.
So can you tell us a little bit about the organization and it's the issue that you are addressing?
Well, the name of the ministry is called the Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network. And the mission of it is to unite Christians to pray and act against human trafficking and related injustices.
Mm. Now, when you say human trafficking, can you break that down a little bit? Because I think people may have, you know, perceptions in terms of really what is human trafficking? And is there a spectrum of what that would encompass?
Yes. Human trafficking is, the definition is the illegal trade of human beings, mainly for the purpose of commercial exploitation or forced labor. Others can be extraction of organs or tissues. There's sex trafficking, involuntary domestic servitude, child soldiers, and like I said, organ trafficking is as well.
Wow. And now, where is this happening?
Everywhere.
Wow. Even in this great United States of America.
Yes, it's happening right under our noses.
Wow. So this is not just something that we hear that's happening in third world countries.
No. It might look different in third world countries, but it is happening right here in the United States.
Wow. So tell us a little bit about when was the organization birthed, and I understand the mission, and why, what was the impetus to be able, for you to be able to address this particular issue?
Well, I do missionary work, and I felt led to move to the city. I'm actually a country bumpkin, and I started praying in the city at Line of Judah with my friend Chris Otto, who has Belonging House Ministry.
Okay.
And as I started praying there, I've just felt the Holy Spirit speak to my heart about moving to the city and ministering to the ones that I was praying for.
Mm.
So supernaturally, the Lord provided a way for me to be able to move into the city. And once I got into the city, the first weekend actually I was here, there was a conference for at-risk youth, which is a big part of where my heart is.
Mm-hmm.
And the Black Ministerial Alliance was putting it on, and I sat next to a woman whose daughter ran the Not For Sale Massachusetts campaign against human trafficking and the abolitionist network. Sarah Durfee is her name. And so we had some discussion. She told me about the book and what Sarah was doing, and that's when I started working with Sarah.
Wow. Well, now, so that was the impetus for you to start doing. So when you say in the city, you're talking about Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan?
All, wherever the Lord leads me. Mm-hmm. I actually answered suicidal helplines. I've done work with hospice. I've tutored youth in Arlington. So I'm kind of wherever the Lord leads me.
Amen.
In that one particular place.
Okay, okay. And tremendous. And so what exactly, so prayer is one piece of it, obviously. But beyond the prayer, the practical activities that you would do to be able to help, one is obviously raising awareness of this particular issue. But in terms of intervention for people who might be caught up into human trafficking, is that a component for intervention? Obviously, the awareness will facilitate some prevention.
Right. Yes. Well, you know, I think, of course, the base of anything is prayer. And once we start praying, God reveals to us what we need to know in order to become part of what he's placed on our hearts. So it all begins with prayer. But some of the things I do is I go into churches to bring awareness. And my heart is really for the church to be part of the solution. So I speak a little bit about the call to justice and actually that God really wants the church to be the, you know, the way that injustices are being treated and for us to be his justice.
Yes.
And so I speak a little bit about that. And then I also work with many different organizations that work against human trafficking and try to kind of assess the communities that I'm speaking to see what part of the solution they can be. Some churches, they're more focused on the homelessness for this homeless shelters all around them. And some churches have a lot of young families, and they would more want to be part of the domestic violence aspect of that. So there's so many ways. I kind of just sit down with church leaders and individuals, see where their heart is, and connect them to the right organization that I work with that helps in that area.
You know, what comes to my mind is the scripture, Micah 6:8.
Yeah.
You know, what's required of us is to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God.
Yes.
And so I noted that you have a quote on some of your literature from Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that states, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about the things that matter."
Yes, that actually really touches my heart, because when I felt as if the Lord was calling me, the main verse he gave me was Proverbs 31:8, where it says to speak for those who can't speak for themselves and to ensure justice for those who are perishing. And that quote from Martin Luther King kind of is playoff of that scripture.
Amen.
So,
and I appreciate that your emphasis is really to kind of empower the church to do this, because really the church uniquely is important. I appreciate that you're working with other social service organizations.
I'm working with really a varied group of organizations. A lot of them actually are already doing justice work, like the Boston Faith and Justice Network.
Yes.
I'm part of the Fair Trade Coalition to make sure that the towns are educated on fair trade and that we have purchase power. I'm trying to bring that kind of information to the church, because many people don't know that kind of information.
Yes.
I also work with Jermaine Lawrence, which is a home for at-risk girls. I have taught crafts there. So I kind of have a wide range of organizations that I work with.
Okay. You know, again, another quote that comes to my mind from Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is that the church must be reminded it's not the master or the servant of the state, but should be the conscience, the critic, and the guide of the state, never its tool. And if the church does not recapture its prophetic zeal, it will become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority.
Yes.
But what comes to my mind to that, so that's the challenge. This is what the church is called to be. This is what Jesus did. He was, you know, the greatest social justice ministry we could think of is, you know, he says that we want to be the greatest in the kingdom of God, we must be willing to serve the least of them.
Yes, and he's the main, Jesus is the person that we look to as so-called abolitionist. He really is the abolitionist that we look to as an example.
Yes.
He's into freeing us.
Yes.
In every way.
In every way.
So, I really feel as if we have to keep focused in our minds that we really are the solution.
Yes.
That he's called us to be.
Yes.
The light of the world.
Yes.
And he tells us not to hide that light.
Yes.
And the salt of the earth. So we really are called to be part of the solution and not just to sit back and talk about it.
And tell me, that's it, because, you know, I'm grieved, quite candidly, with people whom come from a place of whether it's conscious or unconscious, this self-righteous kind of judgmental, like, well, you know, and it just really kind of, you know, feel like, well, if we just do the right things and, you know, and so forth and so on. And so they just feel as though they're not, it's, what would you say to folks whom feel as though this is not something that the church really should be engaged or involved with? It's not our calling, if you will.
Well, there's a couple of things that it takes in order to step up to the plate to for justice work.
Yes, yes.
And the first thing is courage. We have to really see and be courageous to open our eyes to see what's around us.
Yes.
We have to be humble and do what the Lord tells us.
Yes.
And put away our pride, our way of looking at other people, like, well, maybe they got themselves in that situation. We really need to have humility and courage are two of the main components that we need to have. Because it does take courage to be able to see and be around people that are so wounded. And it makes you feel helpless and hopeless unless you become part of the solution, unless you know there is so much that we can do.
Yes.
You know, and there's a lot of stories out there of survivors, and many of those survivors have come to Christ through their journey or because they're survivors because they've come to Christ first.
Yes.
So I've heard many stories that, you know, God just keeps giving me hope to persevere.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the ones that really touch the hearts of people.
Yes.
When they tell their story.
Speaking of story, tell us a little bit about your story, if you don't mind. I mean, so this is the work that you're doing and so forth, but your personal, I mean, this is, you know, what is some of your testimony, some of your personal story, that who is behind Jennie that brought you to this place?
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the reasons why Proverbs 31:8 really speaks to my heart is because there was a time in my life that I felt as if I couldn't speak for myself. I was in, you know, some deep, dark places.
Yes.
And I didn't feel as if there was anybody around me that was really speaking for me either.
Yes.
When I tried to reach out for help, those around me were kind of acting like you had just said. They thought it was from situations that I got myself into. I wasn't being heard.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a big part of why I feel as if I'm called, is because I can relate to those who don't have a voice, because I was a person without a voice for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all have our story and our background from that we come from some woundedness and some hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And mine especially affected my children.
Mm.
And actually, I didn't really understand why the Lord had called me to human trafficking, so to speak. I knew that God always gave me that gift of compassion.
Yes.
I always wanted to be around those who were oppressed.
And, yes.
But there was a survivor speaking and telling a story.
Mm-hmm.
And as she was speaking, I felt like it could have been my daughter.
Mm-hmm.
It could have been my daughter's stories. I have two daughters.
How old are your daughters?
They're 24 and 22.
Mm-hmm.
And so they could be standing up and they could have told the story, but their life took a little bit of a different path.
Mm-hmm.
Their lives have been affected.
Yes.
And I just felt the grace of God. I felt so grateful.
Yes.
And so then I realized, well, that's why human trafficking is so close to my heart.
Yes. So the people whom are, you know, at risk, you know, I mean, for who are the people whom would you say are greater at risk for human trafficking?
Well, there's a lot of there's a lot of different routes. I mean, one survivor speaks and tells her story. She's very courageous. And she didn't come from a family that had poverty.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't come from a broken family.
Mm-hmm.
She just wanted to venture out to the world. So she ran away.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when a pimp had caught her. So anybody that's vulnerable in any situation really is more at risk.
Mm-hmm.
And it can happen to anybody, and she kind of, you know, shows that.
Yes.
That it can happen to anybody. But you know, poverty,
yes,
violence,
yes,
especially for sexual trafficking, I would say the girls who have who are looking. And most girls that are at the age that they come in, it's, the average age is 13. Mm. They're looking for attention.
Yes, yes.
The traffickers sense that. They know that. Mm-hmm. And in foreign countries, it's really poverty is a huge part of it because a lot of the people will sell their children for the sake of the other children. Mm-hmm. They feel desperate. Mm. The poverty is so desperate. Mm-hmm. So those are just a couple of the at-risk, so to speak, things.
Yes.
But it can affect anybody.
Yes.
Nobody is really.
Yes. And so one who might be caught up into, because once one is caught up into it, I'm sure the shame, I'm sure the really the despair and hopelessness that really, like, this is really all I can do. If you're uneducated, if you don't have
know,
resources, then you might feel as though this is. So how would it, you know, someone who might be listening to this broadcast, mm-hmm. or someone whom, how, what are the resources that they can be able to get out of this kind of human trafficking if they feel as though they you know, that they're one of those people who are, what would you say to that person whom is actually caught up into this and really wanting a way out but feeling no way out?
The ones that are already victims?
Yes.
Oh, the ones that are already victims, well, they have to be in a position where they feel safe.
Yes.
So and that's actually a big part of the problem is, you know, the church and people in general want to save those people.
Yes.
But they don't have a safe place to put them.
Yes.
And so that's why it's so hopeless and helpless.
Yes.
But, you know, the Lord is bigger than any problem.
Amen.
There is. And he opens up doors and avenues.
Yes.
For that. I mean, I had a woman call me just the other day and say she heard the last radio broadcast.
Wow.
And she was questioning of her daughter.
Yes.
And that's why she wanted to talk to me.
Mm.
And you know, it's difficult because the situation can be so complex for people that have been victimized.
Yes.
They don't feel, even when they get to a safe place, they run away because they don't still feel safe.
Yes.
And there's not that many resources. That's one of the big main problems of places for them to go.
Mm-hmm.
So you can just love on them.
Yes.
And just try to shine the light of Christ to them.
Yes.
And just spend time with them.
Yes.
And they want to be heard. Most what I hear from the survivors who speak is they want somebody to believe them and just to listen to them.
Yes.
That's huge for them.
Yes.
Because they don't feel as if people will understand or believe,
mm-hmm.
believe them.
Mm-hmm. And how many of them would you say, and even as you, them are actually people whom you think are victims,
mm-hmm.
who then become perpetrators of being able to get other folks in this, you know.
Well, yeah, that is huge. You mean the perpetrators, it's not just the victims that are the victims.
Right.
The perpetrators are victims.
Yes.
Of their own situation.
Yes.
So there's really no bad guy, good guy, even though,
absolutely.
I mean, some do. Some need to be convicted,
sure,
and
sure.
repent.
Sure.
But they still are victims
still
of their
victims.
Own of their own stuff.
Yeah. And so to them, because I appreciate that, we as the body of Christ are mm-hmm. ministers of reconciliation.
Right.
And that's for, you know, in the context of healing our land, impetus was really to address the issue of HIV and AIDS,
mm-hmm.
as it disproportionately impacts underserved, marginalized, mm-hmm. disenfranchised mm-hmm. communities. I mean, here in the state of Massachusetts, African Americans make up 6% of the population,
mm-hmm.
but they're 28% of the people we know to be diagnosed with HIV and or AIDS per the Massachusetts Department of Public Health.
Mm-hmm.
Another 6% of the population is Latino, and they're 25% of the prevalence.
Mm-hmm.
And so
mm-hmm.
communities of color, being Latino and African American, mm-hmm. only 12% of the population per the census,
mm-hmm.
but they're 44% of the people who we know. And as bad as that is, it's worse because there's another 50% of the population who don't know their status,
right,
because they've never taken a test. It's not mandatory that you take an HIV test, and they don't oftentimes even offer it to you unless they see you as a perceived risk. And so worse than that is 83% of the new infections amongst women are women of color.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is something that is really a state of emergency, you know. And in many instances, we talk about HIV and AIDS, as I've been doing quarterly and community forums, and we talk about the root issues. Many of
right.
them are people whom have been sexually exploited.
Yes.
You know, who've been molested, incest, all these kinds of things that have happened that have been the root cause.
Right.
That, and one gentleman in particular who I met as a transgender,
mm-hmm.
living a life, prostituting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to mm-hmm. actually support his one drug addiction,
mm-hmm.
because to, you know, cover the pain,
mm-hmm.
as well as confusion in his own mind that
right.
he started to embrace that he really was a female or, and, you know, trapped in a man's body. So
mm-hmm.
raising the resources to be able to have a sex change.
Mm-hmm.
But I thank God that God gave me compassion to see
mm-hmm.
him through the eyes of Christ,
right.
and to give language that I would call him beloved of God, and bring him into a setting where he could be heard. And
yeah, that's what they need to be.
But we were blackballed. There were people, church people, who stopped coming to this date because they said, why
mm-hmm.
are you giving them a platform? And
mm-hmm.
I'm like, because first she said my house should be called a house of prayer for all people.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And then when we broke up into groups, mm-hmm. and if you were interested in empowering any of these underserved communities,
mm-hmm.
nobody would have wanted to sit with them.
Mm-hmm.
And the host church said to me that they're about to leave. Nobody wants to sit with them. What do we do? I said, sit with them. And they
yes.
did, but we filmed
yes.
their conversation, and immediately they were like, you know, God doesn't want you to be this way.
Yeah, that's what they get. That's why, actually, I went, and I was really, my heart was broken. I went to one conference, and it was filled with people that were working on the demand side of human trafficking. And I was in some forum, and one survivor stood up, and I can't remember exactly what we were talking about, to be honest with you. She said she was sick and tired of these Christians giving them empty promises. Because their life was full of empty promises.
Yes.
That's the last thing they needed to hear was another
yes.
empty promise.
Yes.
They just wanted to be heard.
Yes.
And then she wasn't the only one. There's a couple more that could have kind of stood up and agreed with her.
Yes.
And said, yes, you're right.
Yes.
We don't need that.
It's,
we don't need them to be a hero of us. That's
yes.
not what we want. They're, you know, we don't want to hear about a hero because of what we've gone through.
Yes. Yes.
We just need somebody to sit down with us and say, what can we do to help you?
Yes. Yes.
So, yeah.
And with the, and when you provide that platform,
mm-hmm.
but this particular situation, and so it was so amazing to me because this particular brother whom I met dressed as a woman,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I got such an education
mm-hmm.
of, you know, the lifestyle that I was oblivious to.
Right.
And they were able to engage other transgenders
mm-hmm.
and their stories were similar. But as mm-hmm. they begin to just have a place that they could, that a sterile atmosphere
mm-hmm.
that they could be able to expose the situation, be heard, and start to heal, and have be just loved unconditionally, and the word of God planted in them, not from a place of conviction, of condemnation.
Right, right, right.
But let the Holy Spirit do
the
convicting.
Yeah.
And in time, the gentleman called me and said, Minister Hobbs, mm-hmm. this is brother by his male pronoun and his male name, which I never knew. And he said, the Holy Spirit convicted me, and I don't want to live this life.
Right, right. Yes. You know, my eyes were opened about listening to people, and I really learned a lot about listening was through the suicidal helpline. It wasn't a Christian organization, so we weren't allowed to share our faith. We could just really, what we were supposed to do was to listen to them.
Yes.
No matter what they were saying. I mean, if it got to a place where we needed to let them go, we did.
Yes.
And that happened quite often. but they just wanted to be heard.
Yes.
They just wanted to be heard. Not that we were going to, I mean, I would never agree with them saying, you know, that they're going to do something bad. I wouldn't say, oh, yeah, that's okay.
Right.
But they just wanted to be heard.
Yes.
Because their problems were real. And some of their problems, to me, seemed like, what is your problem? but to them, it was huge.
Yes,
you know.
Yes.
So.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
So for people who might want to be able to support, who are hearing this and are now, you know, enlightened and saying, you know what, I want to help.
Mm-hmm.
How can they help? I mean, how can they reach your organization? How can they, you know, what can they do?
Yeah. Well, I have a blog that actually has links to a lot of the different organizations, and it kind of tells the things that I do, and you can sign up for And to be on an email list, I send out information on how you can get involved in awareness, prayer events. And my blog is www.gbpan.wordpress.com.
Wonderful. And is there an email, a phone number, a website?
Yes. Well, that the blog is my website. Okay. I also have a Facebook page under the Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network.
Okay.
And my email is gbpan2012@gmail.com.
And now, being this broadcast is airing all across the world,
mm-hmm.
I see there's a number here for National Human Trafficking Resource Center Hotline.
Yes, that actually is to call to give a tip. If you think you see something, you can call the number.
Okay.
And they will investigate it.
Okay.
But they also have information. If you have questions, they'll give you resources.
Okay.
And that number is 1-888-373-7888. It's kind of easy to remember that way.
Right. What is it again?
1-888-373-7888.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, yeah, that's Polaris, a project, mm-hmm. which is an organization that actually they have a website. You can see statistics, and it goes by state, and it tells you all the organizations that are helping. But that number you're calling Polaris Projects.
Wow.
They're the ones that did it.
Wow. And now with regard to, so human trafficking would include prostitution.
Yes, sex trafficking is only part of it. There's like I said, there's labor trafficking, there's child soldiers where they, in Sudan, where they teach the children to kill.
Mm.
And they end up killing their own family most of the time, a lot of the time, because they're hardening them up.
Mm.
That was, I think, the most disturbing thing for me to watch and read. Not for Sale is a book. It's a campaign, but it's the campaign is after a book that was written by David Batstone.
Okay.
And that has different stories from different countries and what it looks like in the different countries. And the Sudan was the child soldiers.
Mm.
And again, like I said, there's organ trafficking where people are selling their organs.
Their organs?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like a kidney or...
Really?
Yeah.
This is like a black market?
They're desperate enough. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and forced labor is very big.
Like slavery?
Yes. That's why purchasing power is very important, to know the products that we buy.
Mm-hmm.
You can go on Slavery Footprints, and it will tell you, it will give you like a number. You take a little test and tell you where you bought this and what you buy.
Yes.
And it will tell you how many slaves that you are
using
to have your products.
Now, it's interesting because I was introduced to the Faith and Justice.
Boston Faith and Justice Network.
Yes, and I love the work that they do.
Yes, I'm very connected with Ryan and McDonald. They have a discipleship training that they do called Lazarus at the Gate.
Mm-hmm.
And they teach you about poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And they actually have you put how much you make on a chart
mm-hmm.
to see how high you really are. Everybody that's even in poverty in America is at the top of the chart.
Wow.
Because the third world countries are so poverty.
Wow.
So, and then you learn how to live justly. They give you ways on how you can save money and how you can live sacrificially.
Yes.
And at the end, the discipleship group decides on the money that they've spent, that they've saved to spend on an organization towards poverty.
Wow.
So that's one of the things that they do.
And so for our listeners and our viewers, again, who don't, mm-hmm. what is the name of the organization?
Boston Faith and Justice Network.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And do you know, is it the website or no?
No, I don't
okay.
know it off the top
but
of my head.
That's fine. But
actually, I have all those links on my blog.
Oh.
I have local organizations, I put from victim to victorious.
Amen.
And then organizations that are not really local.
Mm-hmm.
They're just awareness.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have prayer resources.
It's interesting. Our initial introduction, Boston Praise Radio and TV Network, we had the opportunity mm-hmm. to go to, I think it's the Episcopal Church that was downtown Boston Common.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a forum that was talking about Walmart. And
oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, I didn't make that one.
But you heard about that.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And so, and it's interesting because, you know, everybody loves the value that you can get at Walmart, but
yeah.
they have no idea the cost that, yes. And you talk about this notion of slave labor.
Yes.
You know, so speak a little bit to that.
Yes. Well, there's also this, the products that you buy are very important. And there's certain products that are you more slaves are used. Like, yeah. Child labor is big with cocoa and coffee. Yeah, so when you go to the store to purchase these things, they'll have a fair trade label on it, mm-hmm. and that will, you know, prove that the labor is fair, mm-hmm. for the people that are making the products or working on the products.
Wow.
Also, bananas is huge.
Wow.
That's why some bananas you see are very, very expensive.
Yes.
You have to be very careful with that, because the portions of the money that actually go to the people that are doing all the work is minute.
Yes.
It's the other people that are making all the money.
Yes.
So it's a huge, so much to learn.
Yes.
But Boston Faith and Justice Network actually has a book, and it will tell you the stores in the area and the products, that the fair trade products that they sell.
Mm-hmm.
And they do a lot with that. Fair Trade Boston is of course, they have a lot of information to give out.
Mm-hmm.
So,
wow. This is amazing, because, again, people feel, you know, I remember this conversation about Walmart. They had actually employees that were there, and we're talking about they don't have benefits.
Yes, that's why things are cheap, is because they don't treat their employees
very well.
Yeah, I mean.
And that this is really not the vision of the founders of Walmart.
Right. Yeah.
So it just becomes about greed.
Yes, it does become. Greed is one of the main
drivers,
yeah.
of this.
Yeah.
And so, but for people whom, you know, again, aren't aware, and they're just feeling, well, you know, I get a great value. This is why this awareness is so important.
Yes, so. Yes, it is. And actually, it's there's labor trafficking in restaurants.
Wow.
Right in the area.
Wow.
Upper Crust Pizza was cited for trafficking Brazilian women.
Wow.
And actually they went bankrupt.
Wow.
So it's right under our noses.
Yes.
There's a lot of trafficking in nail salons and massage parlors.
Really? And now, yes. For a person, again, whom might, how can we, what are the cues that might tip us off to that, you know, because nail salons and massage parlors, or particularly nail salons, I think, are very prevalent in the inner city, mm-hmm. there, and you see a lot of Vietnamese Asians. Mm-hmm. So how would you know that maybe this is a place that is participating in that, as opposed to a place that's doing this?
Well, you just kind of got to keep your spiritual sense open and your eyes open to how the women are acting. If they're acting, you know, like they're afraid,
yes.
Or if they, a lot of it is that there's one main person that seems to be in charge, and they know English, but none of the workers know English.
Mm-hmm.
That's keeping them a little underneath them, because, you know. So that's kind of one of the signs.
Mm-hmm.
But you just have to kind of go with your spirit.
Okay.
Go with your Holy Spirit. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And again,
and then you can call that 1-800
number.
That's
what you would do.
Yeah.
Okay, tremendous, tremendous. We're going to pause and actually go to a break. But again, I want to thank you so much just for being here. And this information is so important to raise the awareness. And again, the we're going to, when we come back, talk a little bit more about, you know, the mission, the vision, things practically that people can do.
Okay.
And you can call us live at 617-282-0685. You have a question for our guest. And we're going to pause and go to some music, and we will be right back.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred,
war and poverty. Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children to jump the very best they can. Just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it now, just you and me. Wake up all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hair. They don't have so very long judgment day, so won't you make them happy before they pass away? Wake up all the builders, time to build a new land. I know we could do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out, they do it every time. Just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it now, just you and me.
Wake up, wake up, wake up, everybody. That's actually Harold Melvin in the Blue Notes. And that song just speaks to the fact that we do need to wake up. The Bible says in Hosea 4:6 that my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And the word tells us that he would that we prosper and be in good health, even as our souls prosper. And for me, it's not just it's the soul of humanity. It's the soul of society. It's the soul of the world. And so, you know, we as America, the richest and most powerful country in the world, from my perspective, I see that the soul is very sin sick. And so there needs to be a revival. You know, I think that even our economic situation really has to do with the fact that we have not, that we don't as largely trust in God. There's a movement, there's a remnant. You know, there is the church that's happening.
Right, right.
But the reality is, I think that people have put the love of money is the root of all evil.
That's right.
And I think people have made that a God, unfortunately. So talk a little bit, but we were talking off the air during the break a little bit about how this is, some of this human trafficking, how it's manifesting in some other places that are in third world countries or in China in particular.
Oh, okay. Well, I had gone to China 2007, and at the time I didn't know what human trafficking was, but I saw elderly people with babies on their backs.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw it a lot. So I asked the people I was with, I was on a mission trip with a mission team. And what they said to me was that that's the effects of the one child policy. And what happens is they take in the children, especially girls, because the one child policy is that they want to have boys. They look differently at girls than they do at boys in China. And they are actually fined, very high fines, if they have more than one child, unless they pay a certain amount to be able to have that child. So these elderly people are bringing up these infants and these babies, thinking they're sparing them from a life of either being aborted or being just thrown away on the streets. But these kids are expected to take care of them when they get really elderly, because they were pretty old when they were babies. And they're just expected to take care of their homes, take care of them when they get sick. And I saw some girls that were already doing that. I could sense that that's what they were doing. And it just broke my heart.
Sure.
So that's how one way it looks. They have many forced abortions in China, and there is an organization, All Girls Allowed, that Chai Ling, who is a dissident from China, came to America and became a Christian. She started this organization, All Girls Allowed, and they do showers for women who are having girls, and they give scholarships to the women so that they can take care of their family, so that they can have the child.
Wow.
So that's one way it looks like in China. I also have gone to Senegal, and it looked very differently there. The boys actually are trafficked by their parents to the Muslim leaders, thinking that they're learning the Quran and learning how to be respectful and live a good life. But in fact, the boys are thrown on the streets with little bowls that have sugar cubes in them, and that's their food for the day unless they beg for food. And they're expected to bring home a certain amount or they're beaten. I had the honor of going into one of the homes that the boys lived in, which is called Adara, because it was a medical mission trip, so we were immunizing the boys. And the place was very small, dirt floor, half a roof. In the rainy season, they slept in mud. And it was very small. 150 boys lived in this one little room, and goats were in the corner. And to look at the boys, you could see they were malnourished. It was just, quite a difficult day that day that we were in the Dara. But luckily, there's a Christian group that we work with there that actually has a very good relationship with the Marabous, which are the teachers of the Quran. And they're starting to connect with them. And they do medical treatment for the boys, and the Marabous allow that.
Wow. So with China, you said there was a particular agency that actually is...
Yes, it's All Girls Allowed, and you can find that on the web.
Okay.
And Chai Ling wrote a book, A Heart for Freedom, and it tells her story, her story of how she came from China to stand up for girls' rights. And she's a dissident. She was standing up for all kinds of legal things, and then she moved to America and started All Girls Allowed. But it tells her story at the end of Salvation, which is beautiful.
Wow. Yeah. Now, a dissident, help educate me. What is it?
Well, that's just a person that's kind of fighting for things that she was kind of rebellious.
Yes.
She's sticking up for the right things.
Yes.
And fighting against the government. There's a group of them.
Excellent. So the law there in China, this is the law. So, for me, that's a practical manifestation of when we say that spiritual wickedness in high places, that's government.
Right.
So this is the law that is saying, what is it, one child?
One child. Yeah, they were trying to, because there's so many, the population is so high and the land is so little, they were trying to regulate population by saying you could only have one child.
And that one child should be a boy?
Well, there's, because of cultural ways, it's the same as in India, there's also genocide. Girls are just looked differently. They're actually kind of a nuisance because, they cost money, whereas the man goes out and works. And so everybody wants to have boys. They don't want to have any girls, which of course, the population is going down.
Right. So if you just got boys, then you've got, it's like a workforce.
There's all kinds of problems, though. There's increased rape. There's increased violence because there's all these men without women.
Yes.
So it's got all kinds of...
Wow. Yeah. And so that's China. And you said the other place was...
Senegal. Yeah, West Africa.
And what was the agency that's working with that particular entity?
Well, I went to... I went on a mission trip with Shore to Shore Mission Network, and they have, it's through the Christian and Missionary Alliance, it's the church I went to before. Mm-hmm. That's actually how I went to China. Mm-hmm. And they're working with a local church, a local Christian and Missionary Alliance church, and the missionaries from the CMA. And they go once a year, and they're building a school for the boys. So the guys on the team that went with me, all except for the doctor, they worked on building the school. And all us medical people, because I used to work in the medical field, we did medical treatment for the community.
So. Well, you know, bringing it back here locally, you know, I know here in Dorchester, I live right in Fields Corner. And again, with Healing Our Land Ministry, we've done a lot of outreach, prevention, intervention, harm reduction. And so I see prostitution.
Right.
I see the Johns. I see the, and many instances, they're addicts, you know, and there's mental health issues.
Yes.
You know, but I see women whom are caught up, and this is happening on, you know, Talbot Ave, Blue Hill Ave, you know, Washington Street, right? I mean, to me, it's not even under our noses. To me, it's very blatant.
Yeah.
And
some of it is, yes, I agree.
You know what I'm saying? Some of it to me seems so blatant, but the point is, and particularly in, you know, the wee hours of the morning, 3 o'clock, you know, they're walking up and down the street, you know, flagging cars down. And so this is something that you really, and I don't see the church there. I see the police, you know, I see the Johns, you know what I'm saying? But I don't see it. And Healing Our Land has done some, and even I've worked for some entities as an outreach worker and been challenged. Oh, we can't go that hour of the morning. And so that's the reason why we've done through Healing Our Land. In fact, we just trained 40 faith-based recovery coaches. And we're getting another cycle that's getting ready to happen where we're training people via the Bureau of Substance Abuse and the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services from the federal government. And this is training them how to meet people where they are and walk them through a process of recovery. And not imposing it, this is how it looks.
Right.
But letting them, is this working for you? But through relationship and harm reduction, being able to build relationship, as you said, and then through the relationship, you're able to hear their stories. And be able to plant the seeds and water the seeds and pray and connect them to resources. But one of the things that we found, as you said earlier, is there's an entity called Women Connecting Affecting Change. And they're on Blue Hill Ave, and it was birthed out of two women who were living with HIV, who were in addiction and prostitution. Those things kind of go hand in hand.
A lot of times they do.
And so what happened is a lot of times, even when the women get to the point that they're at their bottom and they go into a treatment program and they come out, there is no transitional housing.
No, there isn't. Well, there's actually there's two things going on that are good that are helping out. There's a ministry called Route One Ministry, and they minister to strippers. They go into strip clubs. They start relationships with the strippers. They have a connection that they're able to get into the strip clubs, and so that's been going on for a few years as well. And then there is one safe house that's being built called Amira. It's on the North Shore. It's primarily for 18 and older because that's where there's more complications, more immigration status. Some of the women already have children. They already have a record because they've been arrested for prostitution and now they're an adult. So they decided to focus on that age group because there's less for an adult that's coming out of the life, so to speak. So that's should be opened very soon. They're waiting for the funds to open it. They have the property. So that's called Amira. And then Route One Ministry is another ministry that's doing it. But it's such a complex and convoluted problem that I talked to just somebody this week that says, well, I just want to do outreach. I just want to go to the people and tell them we have a safe place to bring you. I said, well, we don't have a safe place to bring them.
Wow.
You can have a relationship with them and you can be nice to them and you can show them Christ's love, but you can't give them empty promises. That will only make it worse.
That's it. And with that said, there's an entity The particular entity, Women Connecting Affecting Change, they actually found a home that was here in the Ashmont Hill area. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, they were able to get the home for like a dollar or something because it was an abandoned building. Mm-hmm. They found people who were able to donate their skill set to totally refurbish the home with Kurt. And the women were actually living in this home. But the neighborhood association constantly kept bringing them to court for these minor infractions and just basically their fears. Well, if these women are here, they're going to be bringing the men here, and their fears, you know, right, about having those people in our neighborhood.
Right.
So what would you speak to? What would you say to people whom, you know, who might feel that way? Because, you know, as ministers of reconciliation and to assuage their, some of their fears, and people feel like they're excluded from them because they're over there, and nobody wants to have these kinds of programs. And there are plenty of buildings right here, and Patty and I see all the time as we're driving through the city, these abandoned buildings that could be transitional houses and homes.
Right, right. And the process, like I said, again, is you have to be very, you do have to be cautious because it's a business, and the people who are making the business are treating it like a business.
Yes.
So the people who are helping have to also treat it like a business.
Yes.
They have to make sure all their ducks are in a row.
Okay.
Before they step into some pretty deep waters.
Yes.
Because the problem is so huge.
Yes.
But out of the neighborhoods, I mean, it's everywhere you see and you walk, you work around. I think the best thing to do is to try to come to grips with what can I do personally? What do I have as a Christian, as a lover of Jesus? How can I represent Jesus to them?
Yes.
Is it just by sitting with them and,
yes,
and spending time with them?
Yes.
Is it by mentoring young youth so that they don't get
caught up in it?
You know, is it teaching others about justice or bringing awareness? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so much. Or is it just prayer? Some people are just praying. I mean, this Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday.
Yes.
And it's one of the main places where prostitutes are sold.
Really?
Yes. And so Sunday is Pray for the John Sunday.
Really?
Also. Yeah. Sporting events, political campaigns.
Yes.
They're sold through the internet in hotels.
Wow.
Because it's all about demand. It's a business.
Mm.
So we're actually praying Friday morning about and Mardi Gras is the Super Bowl is where Mardi Gras is. So we're praying for the Super Bowl and Mardi Gras. And then Sunday, there's a website called Pray for the John Day.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go on that website. They have prayer points, and they have why it's important to pray for the Johns. Pornography, of course, is a huge draw into, it's very much connected into men buying prostitutes because they can't get enough from just the pornography. They have to revert to something more.
Mm-hmm.
So
with those, with the what is the day called again?
Mm-hmm.
This coming Sunday?
Yeah.
And so is that something that people can participate in?
Yes, they can. I'm actually having a conference call. I don't think I have the number right here with me.
No way.
But I have a conference call Friday morning at 7 o'clock.
Okay.
We're gathering together to pray.
Amen. Amen. So could they go to the blog?
They can go to the blog to get information.
About the prayer.
Yeah.
Okay. And that has specific prayer points. And is that something, with regard to the prayer network, that's something that happens ongoing? And if one wants to participate in the network, is it also something?
Yes, so you can go on the blog or on Facebook. You can sign up for emails, updates on my Facebook page. I have a Twitter. It's Jenny at Justice Delivery. And I have the blog.
And Jenny, how you spell that?
J-E-N-N-I-E.
Okay.
Yeah.
At Jenny?
At Justice Delivery.
At Justice Delivery. I like that.
Yeah.
Then?
And that's Twitter.
That's your Twitter name. To follow you.
Yeah, okay. If you want to follow me. But you can get my Twitter or my Facebook on my blog. Everything is on my blog.
It's on the blog.
That would be the place to go to get
all Yeah, honestly, I'm really just getting into this tech-savvy stuff, really. I mean, here at Boston Praise Radio, Pastor Wall is really the guru. And so I'm pretty fluent with Facebook.
Yeah.
Twitter, I'm really still kind of feeling my way. But blogs, I mean, I really don't really even really comprehend. Is blogs just like as simple as like a going to the website and you can just see the information? What?
Yeah, so blog, it looks like a website.
Okay.
Yeah, you can make it look like a website. So it has things on. Like I said, it has all my links, yes. And then it has about me. You can go to different places on the blog. It looks like a website,
okay.
Really.
Okay. And is it something that you can engage in, like interactive, or is it just didactic? It's just information.
It's just information. They can sign. You can sign up for my email, and I'll have your email.
Okay.
Or you can follow my blog if you have a WordPress.
Okay.
That's kind of how it works.
Okay. Now, and so with regard, you also said you have Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. And so your Facebook name would be?
It's the Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network. Okay. And I have a personal one, Jennie Fournier.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how do you spell that?
Jennie is my first name.
Yes.
My last name is Fournier.
Okay. Yes. I want to talk a little bit about the beautiful picture. Patty Lee was gracious enough to create a flyer for this broadcast.
Oh, okay.
And it had the picture of the artwork. That talk a little bit about that picture.
Oh yes, the picture. Actually, you can't see the bottom of it. She's coming out. She's coming out of the woman is holding up ribbons, and she's coming up, coming out of barbed wire.
Yes, barbed wire.
Yeah, on her feet. You can't see that in that particular picture.
No.
But it shows it in the big picture. But they had. There's different ways you can get, of course, engaged, and one of the ways artists can get engaged is they were having an awareness. Event, I guess. I'm trying to think of what you call it when you show your art. They had art, like photographs and art that was bringing awareness about human trafficking, all displayed at Equal Exchange Cafe mm-hmm. for a few months. Mm-hmm. And so that picture that Patty put was my friend Chris Otto. He's an artist, and he did that piece to bring awareness about human trafficking.
Wow.
So that was, he wanted to bring out the aspect of the hope and of a victorious woman with holding the ribbons up. And
beautiful, so, beautiful. Yeah. So he painted it.
He's an artist. So,
wow. And now talk a little bit about, he has a ministry you referenced a little bit earlier.
Yes, Belonging House. And he really is more for the artist. He's actually writing a book about an army arising and the place that the artists have in the kingdom and that they have such a huge place.
Yes.
So it's really full of information talking about what the Bible says about artists and artisans. And so he also does a house of prayer in Salem.
Mm-hmm.
So he was a fellow missionary and co-laborer with me that we've been working together for quite a few years.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Praise God. And we want to send greetings to our sister, a.k.a. Deliciously Free Me, in the instant chat room, as well as Ascension Expected. Thank you so much for being tuned in, and all of those who are tuned in via the Gospel Music and Productions Network, those who are tuned in via the Sela Radio Ministry, those who are tuned in via Facebook. And again, if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to be able to engage our very special guest, Jennie Fournier, who is here, who is the founder and director of the
Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network.
Network.
Yes. And a couple of other organizations that I work with are prayer-related or Apostolic and Prophetic. Pure Spring Institute
yes.
is one of them that what I do with them is I'm the cultural engagement with compassionate action. So I try to bring the apostolic and prophetic into action. And so I work closely with them. Aglow International actually has an anti-human trafficking
initiative. That's the
initiative. Woman's Aglow? Yes.
Amen.
Yeah, they have an anti-human trafficking initiative. So I've been connected with them. They join me on my conference calls quite often. And they intercede for me and with me.
Amen.
On a regular basis.
Amen.
And the Abolitionist Network is a huge part of what I do, and Sarah Durfee runs that through the Emmanuel Gospel Center. And so that's refreshing abolitionists and connecting them and finding ways. And like I said, she's been running the Not For Sale Massachusetts campaign, and lately we're trying to get the community assessment with different leaders of the community that are already engaged in the fight against human trafficking.
Now, because we've got folks who are tuned in from all across the world, our sister, a.k.a. Deliciously For Me, is actually a pastor in Atlanta, Georgia. And again, we've got our networks in New York and in Chicago, and clearly this is happening all across the United States.
Right.
So that assessment facet, can you talk about how people might engage in that in their respective locales?
Yes. I've been connected with the International Justice Mission. Jim Martin, who is executive director of Church Mobilization. He wrote a book called The Just Church, which is part of a program called DIVE, and they have all types of resources that lead the church into assessing their community and seeing what place they can have. It's where I get a lot of my information on what a just church would look like, or biblical scriptures. They have, you know, what does God think about injustice?
Yes.
And what is your part in it?
Yes.
So it does a lot of other things as well, but I'm more connected with the church mobilization part of IJM. They do a lot of political policy. There's a Massachusetts IJM advocacy group.
Wow.
But I'm more connected with the church mobilization part of it.
Tremendous. You know, the whole mobilization, it's much of the mission of healing our land is actually to facilitate a collective movement, but through trainings, you know, collective and action. And I saw, you know, your mission and your vision, and it mirrors, because that's prayer. Everything has to be bathed in prayer, right? And so many of us love to quote that scripture, but the practical application, you know, that to me is, you know, I believe that through that prayer, as you said, the Holy Spirit will conceive and birth through us what I call His immaculate conception. I believe we each have an immaculate conception that supersedes our natural conception. And that's our part of the collective body of Christ, that all the creation's waiting for us to assume our positions.
That's
you talked
right.
about, you know, Brother Chris, and the arts and entertainment. That's one of those. That's those seven mountains.
Right.
You know, the media, what we're doing here, and all this technology and social media and so forth. I believe that we are to have dominion over every respective domain. That's how we bring in the broader kingdom of God on earth in a practical way. What do you say?
Yes, actually, there's a lot of practical ways that you can be part of the solution. And like I said, a lot of it depends. When I meet with church leaders and individuals, I want to see where their heart is, what their personal story is, and how they want to help the community that they're in, or the community that really is their Israel, so to speak.
Yes. Their Israel.
Yeah. You
I
never
like
heard
that.
Of that?
No.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. So, and it might not even be the community that they live in.
Yes.
But where is their heart? What is it that they want to, what do they have to offer?
Yes.
What is God placing on their heart? Some of them are just interested in helping out with the sexual trafficking.
Yes.
Some of them are very interested in the labor trafficking.
Yes.
Because they're immigrant based. Or a very diverse group.
Yes.
And so it really varies from person to person
what
practical ways they can. Some of them are already social workers, and they have a heart, and they want to spread Christ in that way.
Yes.
So they have connections. And some of them are politically savvy, which I'm not.
And
so they want to stand up for what's right politically. They want to get involved in legislation and all that's all those particulars.
Yes.
So this, and I mean, even in just your church, the way that you can get the church ignited, and it all kind of, it begins with prayer, but then There's awareness things that you can do. There's films, there's documentaries, there's book clubs or Bible studies. Mm. And those are kind of the first baby steps into the call to justice.
Mm.
And then the second step would to assess the community that they want to serve, or what group of people that does that church particular have a heart for.
Mm-hmm.
They assess that,
mm-hmm,
and find out what they can do, who can they connect with.
And so is there a method or a process to be able, for one, to do that assessment?
Yeah, that IJM has those assessment tools.
Oh.
They have them available.
Tremendous. And what's that website?
That's IJM.org.
Okay, that stands for?
International Justice Mission.
Okay.
They actually do a lot of international work,
mm-hmm,
empowering women,
mm-hmm,
and empowering all kinds of victims of trafficking.
Okay.
And they work with the political advocacies groups in the different countries that they work with. They have certain offices.
Wow. Our sister, Pastor Marsha, a.k.a. Deliciously Freemi, is in the instant chat room, and she's asking, mm-hmm, what's the name of that book again?
Oh, The Just Church.
The Just Church.
But she can get the free resources through IJM. It's called Dive. If you go on IJM's website, you go on to church, and they actually send you a free copy of the book. They send you a whole packet.
What's the website again?
www.ijm.org.
IJM.org.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that stands for one more
International time. Justice Mission.
Okay. Tremendous. Wow, this is just such a wealth of information. I know Pastor Wall was so compelled via the information you came over on the first time,
mm-hmm,
and we're honored to be able to have you be on Healing Our Lands broadcast. And I know that he is really desiring to afford the platform for, mm-hmm, you to come on ongoing,
mm-hmm,
to be able to address this particular issue and continue to raise awareness. We do have a commercial, I believe, that Sister Reverend Marion Skeet helped to create.
Yes, I actually was on her broadcast.
You
that was the first broadcast I was on.
Was that on WEZE?
Yes.
Ah.
Yes, that was a couple months ago, I think.
Well, we continue to air that promo, and just to continue to raise the awareness and point people to your organization.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, no, it's our pleasure. But again, these are the issues that are the heart of our pastor,
mm-hmm,
and utilizing the media,
mm-hmm,
to be able to amplify these issues,
right,
and so that people can be able to be aware and engaged.
Mm-hmm.
So, and utilize the media to facilitate that mobilization and build, mm-hmm, infrastructure and capacity in what I call the state of emergency, because this is an urgency. This is nothing, mm-hmm, that it's a state of emergency healing and empowering,
mm-hmm,
movement.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, there are entities, as you said, that people, I think, are oftentimes confused, even that are allegedly addressing these issues,
mm-hmm,
but they do have sometimes these hidden political agendas, you know, even as it relates to HIV and AIDS. I mean,
yeah.
I have to put this out there because,
mm-hmm,
you know, a lot of times if you're really doing the ministry of reconciliation,
mm-hmm,
and you're full of justice, I'm sorry, full of mercy,
right,
but never compromising truth,
mm-hmm,
but restoring in a spirit of meekness,
mm-hmm,
but your goal is the ministry of reconciliation,
mm-hmm,
then oftentimes you are blackballed, you are marginalized,
mm-hmm,
from the entities that want to do the political correct kind of a thing,
mm-hmm,
that sometimes compromise,
mm-hmm,
the truth and the real reconciliation,
mm-hmm,
that needs to happen. And you keep people dependent upon services, you know,
right,
and programs,
right,
as opposed to eliminating the need,
yes,
to even exist.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, because we have to get to the root causes, and IJM in the Just Church book, it kind of gives charts as to the related injustice, like domestic violence, poverty, you know, the young men in and out of prisons, addictions,
mm,
homelessness.
Mm.
It just goes on, and he gives you a chart on how to put those injustices in place, and then look into, you know, make a list of those facilities that are addressing those issues, and then find ways on how the church can get engaged with them. You know, like speaking to the people that are running them, or and so to find avenues for the church to be mobilized,
yes,
into the fight. So the book is really a very good resource.
Amen. Our sister, Pastor Marsha, is saying, "Wow, thank you." Say, getting to the roots Amen. And I know one of the things that we're endeavoring to do here, you know, Pastor Wall is endeavoring to do a conference about one specifically to the violence. Mental health is such an issue. Even as we talk about this, what happened in Sandy Hook and, mm-hmm. you know, the violence and where do the guns come from. And though that's a piece of it, another major part is the mental health of people, you know, post-traumatic stress.
Right.
You know, as we see people, there's a lot, there's this outcry of these mass murders. Mm-hmm. But there's like this ongoing murder that happens in the inner city that's like accepted. And people are outraged, as should be, because these were in the suburb, because these were children, and because it was so many at one time. But the reality is there's this chronic, you know, mass murder that's happening from children right in the inner city, and it becomes acceptable. But the reality is, so it speaks to the mental health. You know, even a culture of violence. And so one of the things that Pastor Walt, that's a conference that's forthcoming, but also we at Healing Our Land are endeavoring to do a conference, and we're not sure when, maybe June, July, that we're calling a comprehensive state of emergency healing and empowering conference. And so we would love for yourself to come and, you know, entities addressing homicide, addressing, you know, human trafficking, addressing, because all of these things I think are interconnected. And I think they're all quite candidly symptoms of the social determinants
and the spiritual
you know, so we've got to come from it from a place of ministers of reconciliation, bathed in prayer, but taking dominion and having practical kinds of programs. I believe there's a shift of resources, because quite candidly, in this economic climate, there's plenty of documentation of the problem, health disparities, the recidivism rate, you know, and we're short in resources, but the problem is getting worse, particularly in the underserved communities, you know, poor communities, black communities. And so this is about money, and this is about greed. And so the this is the practical, our battle is not against flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world. So we can say that, but the practical application of us coming together, building these networks, that we can be able to quantify, qualify, document, and capture unprecedented outcomes and impact, that we can shift the resources from what's not working. I believe it was Albert Einstein who said insanity is doing the same thing and expecting it to have a different result. We do have an African-American president who is in his second historic term. And he stated that he kept talking about we as opposed to I. And so I think he's laid the foundation for us to get back to the movement. It's not even about a political party. It's not just about being engaged. It's about us really doing a paradigm shift.
Yeah, we do need a paradigm shift.
In the whole way that we do ministry. So, it's, you know, people think, well, I voted and I'm done. No, we've got to change the whole framework. And so our hope is that this conference, particularly right here in the city of Boston, because I think Boston is really, it is kind of, it sets the tone, good and bad, in many instances for things that happen all across this country and even across the world. So we have an opportunity right here at Global Ministries Christian Church, and we're looking for those to partner with us and people to connect with entities that already exist. And let's build, let's connect the dots. You know, let's amplify, and let's, so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We can't do it all, but we know who's doing what, and we bring the people out of the four walls of their agencies, their ministries, and we bring them in, and we use technology and media to be able to simulcast, and people can engage us like they're doing in the instant chat. We can have, you know, New York and our respective network entities being able to talk about how this looks in those respective places, what are the resources in those places, and then to do this ongoing.
There's a, there's another organization too that has a similar passion. And it's led by Daisup Han. And he wants to do a conference in all the different cities, and it would look different in each city, but it's bringing the heart of the fathers to the children. And he wants to know what the millennial generation, he calls it the millennial generation. I think he explains it from going from 1980 to 2000, those born in those years are very activist oriented. But they don't know the father's love because of the mistakes of the their father's generation. Didn't show them. So so he's addressing that issues, and he has a new website up, and I don't know, I think it's Father's Heart. The love of the Father's Heart. But if you look up, if you Google dice up Han.
How do you spell that?
D-A-I-S-U-P-H-A-N.
Okay.
And if you look up Prayer Surge Now or National Highway of Prayer, he does many conference calls. He's actually having another one Saturday against human trafficking. He does a lot of justice ones. Mm. So if you go on Prayer Surge Now, you can get the information about the conference call that Saturday. And people from all over call his conference calls.
Yeah, Sister Patty Lee, she participated in the conference call and gave me the opportunity to participate in it, and it was powerful.
Yeah, I was on that. I was leading one of the prayer points in that particular conference call. That's why Patty knew about it. So I was trying to, and so he really has a heart of spreading this everywhere.
Yes.
In Boston, it might look different.
Yes.
Than in California. He's from California. He's from Chico. He actually works with Youth with a Mission in Chico, California. But it's really refreshing to see that God is giving us all missions that are so interconnected.
Yes. Yes.
And so he was just another one I wanted to.
Amen. Praise God. You know, it's interesting. 2012, we were taught was here at Global Ministries, the theme was discipling the body.
Mm-hmm.
And I understood 12 to be the number of governmental order. Mm-hmm. And for me, it's divine governmental order.
Mm-hmm.
As we talk about taking dominion. And here in 2013, our theme here at Global is that we're walking in the favor of God.
Mm-hmm.
But to walk in that favor of God, we're also learning the cost of that is obedience to God.
Mm-hmm.
And so being discipled was the prelude and continues to be the prerequisite, because we've got to be in the Word. We've got to be in prayer so that we can be transformed. The Word tells us not to be conformed to the pattern of the world, but transformed by the renewing of our mind. So as, daunting as these issues are, I really believe and feel that this is the church's finest hour.
Mm.
Matthew 16:18 talks about, upon this rock, and that's that unified body of authentic believers who have intimacy with the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I will build my church and the gates of hell
will not prevail.
So that's the good news. I mean, for me, it's very exciting, though we're heavy in, with what's happening around. We hear these kinds of issues and it can be really daunting and it can be really heavy. Mm-hmm. But I think that has to move us to a place of intercession.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's important because when we intercede, as I've stated before, that's how God's heart can be put in our hearts, and that's where we can see his vision and his mission.
Yes.
And none of these ministries or conferences are anything about us.
Yes.
It's an honor and privilege to be used by the Lord in that way.
Yes.
But it's all that God's holy purposes are being brought forth.
Yes.
That his righteousness is shining like the dawn.
Yes.
It's all about his glory.
Amen.
And it's interesting to see that those who came from, the lowest of the lows, God is using. He's taking the weak to shame the wise.
Yes.
He's teaching us to comfort others with the comfort he has given us.
Amen.
So that's the hope that I get, is to hear of other stories of your ministry.
Praise God.
And all the other ministries that God is bringing forth.
Yes.
He's birthing
all
these ministries so that we can work together for his kingdom.
Amen. In the conference call, one of the things that impressed me with a particular brother, what's his name again? Dysop. I think he's relatively young.
Yes, he is pretty young.
Okay.
Yeah.
But just the humility and the fact that this was not about big names and no money,
you
don't pay any resources.
Humble. No. Yes, he said actually this is not a conference to make money. This is a conference because his heart is really for the unity of the body of Christ.
Yes.
And to bring those forth together.
Yes.
And to bring the next generation up to the place that they need to, so that they know the Father's love.
Yes. Yes.
So, yes.
Amen. Amen. Jenny, I'm going to ask you one more time if you can actually, for the listeners of you, this broadcast is streaming live. It will be recorded and it will go up to YouTube. It'll also be on Healing Our Land's Facebook page as well as we will put it on Boston Praise Radio and TV Network's page, and certainly we'll send it to you if you want to put it on your page. Or, but so you can digest this more. It's a lot of information, and so you can digest it at your leisure by pausing and rewinding and going back and forth. That's the neat thing about technology, is you can digest it as is, you know, palatable for you. But if you could once again just articulate to folks who might be interested in learning more about, to be connected to you, your Facebook, your webpage, your blog, or how they can, and your ministry.
Okay, well, the name of the ministry again is the Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network. You can get the information that I've been speaking about, the links, resources, events that are happening on my blog, which is www.gbpan.wordpress.com. I also have a Facebook page under the Greater Boston Prayer and Action Network. I have a personal page, which doesn't have as much information, but I do put some information on that under Jennie, J-E-N-N-I-E, and my last name is F-O-U-R-N-I-E-R. I also have a Twitter account, and it's Jennie, J-E-N-N-I-E, at Justice Delivery.
Amen. I'm going to ask you just before you leave, one, I want to just thank you again for being with us on today and sharing this vital information, and just for the work that you do. God bless your ministry, and we look forward to collaborating with you and being able to have you come and be a part of this conference that's forthcoming. But if you could, just before we close out, if you would just lead us in a word of prayer with regard to, as the Spirit just leads you.
Okay.
Amen.
Okay. Oh, Father, we just, we thank you for all that you are. We thank you that you are a God of justice, that you hate robbery. Lord, we thank you that you call all unto yourself. Lord, that you are our Redeemer, that you are our Father, and that you are our friend. And I pray today, Lord, that you have spoken to the hearts of the people that are listening, to call them to the place that they need to be, to do the work of justice, to be part of the solution. And I ask, Lord, that if it has touched somebody in a personal way, Lord, that you... you bring healing to that secret place, Lord, for we know that these things can touch each of us in a personal way, and that you are our healer, that you can comfort us so that we can take that comfort and comfort others, so that we can speak for those who can't speak for themselves. So we just give you all the glory.
Yes,
we thank you that you are our hope and our Savior.
Yes,
and we thank you that you are the one that will set the prisoners free.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you, Father. Amen. 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 Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome. We're going to let the music play.
Jesus, I am so glad you died for me. So glad you shed your blood just for me. So for me, sweet Jesus, yeah, Jesus, sweet Jesus, Jesus, help me sing,
Jesus.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Yeah! need to give him worship.
Jesus.
How I love him and oh yeah.
Jesus.
How I love him, oh yeah.
Jesus.
How I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him.
Jesus.
How I love him, I love him.
Jesus.
How I love him, I love him, I love him.
Jesus.
See, I don't need a dance posse, cause I got Jesus. I gotta give him glory.
Hallelujah, God. Glory, glory, glory to your name, God. Thank you, Father. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. In the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy. And in his right hand are pleasures evermore. God will do exceedingly, abundantly far above all we could ever ask or ever think. The Lord reigns. Hallelujah, God. You reign, God. In spite of what it looks like, in spite of what it feels like, we hold this confidence that you will complete the work, God, that you've begun in and through us as the author and the finisher of our faith. Father, we glorify you, God. We reverence your Savior. Glory, glory, Father. Thank you, Father, that no weapon formed against us will prosper, God. Thank you, Father, that you have already destroyed the works of the enemy. It's finished, God. God, we thank you, Father, that you reign, God, that you're sovereign. You're all-powerful, God. You're all-knowing in your every place, God, at the same time. Thank you for that powerful name of Jesus. We want to thank our sister Jennie Fournier for being with us and talking about this important issue of human trafficking and all of its manifestations. We trust that you were educated as we were educated and that you were challenged and convicted to be able to move to action in prayer first and foremost. If we, God's people who are called by his name, would humble ourselves and pray and see God's face and turn from our wicked ways, then God will hear from heaven, forgive our sin, and he will heal our land. Our land desperately needs healing. We send our prayers and our condolences to the Kelly family. We've learned that our beloved brother Dana Kelly, actually a gentleman from here in Boston who I believe moved to Florida, we learned the confirmation is that he actually choked to death and was found dead in his apartment. And so we send prayers to the family as we grieve the loss of our beloved brother, Dana Kelly. We solicit the prayers of the body of Christ to be able to intercede on behalf of the family that's grieving. We I'm on Facebook and see all this information that's happening in terms of tornadoes and people whom have actually passed away. Thank our brother Minister Richardson for being able to consistently tune into the broadcast, share his transparent testimony of God delivering him from confusion and sexually, emotionally, and talked about his transparent testimony of incest and molestation and prostitution and things that he was engaged in, drug addiction and so forth. And we're so grateful that he is able to overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of his testimony. His brother, our beloved brother now, Eli, who also shared a similar testimony, our pastor and friend, brother Pastor James Harrell, right from here in the city of Boston, pastor of the Urban Fellowship right here in Dorchester, and how these kinds of transparent, authentic testimonies are what is going to be able to facilitate the great movement of the global revival, or the amplifying the voice of the church that's alive and well here in New England and all across the globe. And so we are excited about people who are willing to humble themselves and pray and seek God's face and turn from our wicked ways so God can forgive our sin and he can heal our land as we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, as we walk by faith and not by sight. And so we're asking you to partner with us. We are excited about implementing our first conference here at the Global Ministries Christian Church. We're so grateful for our senior pastor and visionary pastor, Bruce and Pastor Karen Wall, the senior pastors of the Global Ministries Christian Church, parent body of the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. Humbled to be able to serve and to grow here at this great work. And God is truly amplifying the Global Ministries Christian Church. That is many members, but one body. We are interconnected globally, and Pastor has a heart. And I'm grateful that God's given him a vision via the media for us to be able to facilitate the Great Commission in this ministry of reconciliation, being fishers of men. And so we're excited about our network partners, being the Sela Radio Ministry based in the Bronx, New York, via www.selaradioministry.com. That means to stop, to think, and to pause. We're grateful for the leadership there and their humility to be able to co-labor with us to let this broadcast simulcast in the Bronx, New York, daily from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time in New York, and every evening from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. We, Boston Praise Radio and TV Network's content simulcast on the Sela Radio Ministry. Likewise, we air their content and have that simulcast here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. We also have another entity, being the Gospel Music and Productions Network, based in Chicago or Zion, Illinois, and they also simulcast our content every day from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. However, they are Central Standard Time there, so that's actually 6 a.m. to, I believe, 9 a.m. I think they're 1 hour behind us. That's the Central Standard Time. And we also simulcast on the Gospel Music and Productions Network every evening from 3 p.m. until 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and 2 p.m. and 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. Click on Channel 2 and you can hear Boston Praise Radio and TV's network. Healing Our Land also comes on every Saturday, 11 p.m. through to Sunday morning, 6 a.m. on what's called the Church of the Midnight Hour. And that broadcast is simulcasting via WRCA 1330 a.m. That's an AM network entity that people are tuning in faithfully from respective houses of correction, the Suffolk County House of Correction, the Nashua County Jail, and we are being now connected to other houses of correction. And so the brothers are tuning in faithfully. They're writing us. We're able to give them hope even in that dark place and facilitate deliverance and healing. We're able to amplify their voices by reading their letters that they're writing us. We're able to do advocacy for them. We're able to connect them to resources, transitional housing, the Access to Recovery program, a $500 voucher with recovery coaching and with stabilization and engagement services, with job training and a host of resources, and to advocate for the resources that don't exist. Most importantly, we've gotten favor from the administration to implement a discipleship series within the institution while they're incarcerated. God's given us favor to unapologetically introduce them to the Word of God, disciple them in studying the Word of God, growing strong in God's family, and that they can be able to have deep roots in God's family and produce fruit in God's family. There's a discipleship series that we have gone through here and are going through at the Global Ministries Christian Church called the Colossians 2:7 Discipleship Series. And Colossians 2:7 talks about being rooted and built up in Him, being Jesus Christ, strengthened in the faith as we were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. When a tree takes root, burrowing deep into the soil, it's not long before that action is mirrored above ground. New branches shoot out, green healthy leaves appear, even the trunk grows sturdier, more storm resistant. And so it is with us. The deeper we root our life in Christ, the stronger we'll become. Each book in the 2:7 series contains a dual focus: personal growth and sharing your life in Christ. This second study in the series will help you learn how to make Christ the Lord of your life. You'll discover how easy it is to branch out by reviewing your spiritual life and sharing it with others. With its biblical and practical approach to discipleship, the workbook will yield long-term, life-changing results, such as a closer relationship with God, a desire and a method to memorize scripture passages, a cohesive, useful, personal testimony, and the ability to spend extended time with God. The series, the 2-7 series, offers approaches for strengthening your own life in Christ and for helping others move closer to God. Book 1 is Growing Strong in God's Family. The first book in the 2-7 series is designed to help you to build a strong foundation for your Christian life through enriching Bible study, scripture memory, and group interaction. Again, with its biblical and practical approach to discipleship, the workbook will yield long-term life-changing results, such as a closer relationship with God, a keener sense of priorities, a renewed concern for non-Christian friends, and a growing camaraderie within the Bible study group. And book 3 is Bearing Fruit in God's Family. Each of the books are $14 a piece, and we have the opportunity to put them in the hands of every brother and sister who is incarcerated as we go into the prison and share our strength, our hope, and our experience, discipling them in the Word of God. So above and beyond the being connected to practical resources, transitional housing, job training, where they're being paid through a apprenticeship program called Future Hope Program, advocating for housing, connecting them to housing that already exists, and being able to connect them to resources they can be contributing members of society and be the kings, the priests, and the prophets of their home, particularly as the men of God that God has called for them to be. We need your help to be able to get these books into their hands, and you can go to Healing Our Land's website, www.healingourland.org. No donation is too small or too large. We are a 501c3 non-for-profit organization. We'd be happy to furnish you with a letter for your tax deduction purposes, as we're in tax season and people are preparing for their tax to prepare their taxes. We encourage you to prayerfully consider how you might sow seed into the ministry of Healing Our Land Incorporated Ministry and partner with us. We need your prayers above and beyond anything. Those who would partner to cover us with prayer, to cover these brothers. We got a growing prayer list of our brothers who are incarcerated asking, please pray for me. They don't want to live the lifestyles that they were living, but they need help. They need spiritual help. They need practical help. Some of them are coming out of prison with no clothes, with no place to live, with no job, with no income, and with no supports, because they're cutting off their networks that they had before and the lifestyles that they were living with drug addiction and or drug sales. Many of them are dealing with mental health illnesses, terminal illnesses, HIV, AIDS, and so they're exposing and they're disclosing, and as she said, we can't give them empty hope. We've got to give them practical hope. Jesus said, when I was in prison, you didn't visit me. When I was naked, you did not clothe me. When I was hungry, you did not feed me. When I needed shelter, you didn't provide it for me. And they said, Master, when did we see you in that state? And he said, when you did not do it to the least of them, you didn't do it unto me. We are the light. We are the salt of the earth. And we've lost our savor, the ability to preserve life and to be able to bring light in the dark places. Then we are good for nothing but to be trodden underfoot. But I know that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And there is a remnant, and we implore you to be a part of that remnant. We are confident. The Bible says that the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. So pray that God would send laborers into the vineyard. So we are praying, and we solicit you to pray with us. We know that our battle, again, is not against flesh and blood, but it is against principalities. It is against powers. It is against the rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. But our weapons are not carnal, but they are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. One believer can put 1,000 demonic forces to flight, and 2 in agreement can put 10,000 to flight. Thank you so much, our sister, deliciously framing woman of God. We thank you so much for tuning into the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network, your consistent support of this ministry, your prayers, you doing what God has called for you, doing, being obedient to the Spirit of God. We thank you for your encouragement even on tonight. She stated that she only caught 30 minutes or so, but it was a blessing. Thank you, woman of God. God bless you. This will be recorded. It will be up to YouTube. It will also be on Healing Our Land's brand new Facebook page. We encourage all of our listeners to please visit. Healing Our Land has a new Facebook page. Minister Franklin Hobbs, Franklin Wendell Hobbs, F-R-A-N-K-L-I-N, Wendell, W-E-N-D-E-L-L-H-O-B-B-S, is my personal Facebook page, and we will have our broadcast archived there, and they'll also now be archived on our Healing Our Land Incorporated Ministries Facebook page. We want to thank our sister Patty Lee for the creation of that page, and she has been a gift to the ministry of Healing Our Land and her administrative skills and in her host of skills and just her heart before God, her love for the Lord. We ask you to lift up our sister Patty Lee. We ask you certainly to lift up myself, lift up the Healing Our Land Incorporated ministry. We understand that whom much is given, much is required. And where there's unity, there is strength. There's nothing that we cannot do when we are unified. The enemy would have us to fight each other rather than to fight the principalities and the powers and the spiritual wickedness in the high places, and to own our own human depravity and humble ourselves and see how can we edify, how can we build up, how can we restore each other in a spirit of meekness. And that can only happen from fruit of the Spirit of God. The Bible says that you'll know a tree by the fruit that it bears, and the fruit of the Spirit of God is love. Love never fails. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not boast. Love is not proud. Love is never rude. Love is not self-seeking. Love is not easily angered. Love keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with truth. Love always protects. Love always trusts. Love always hopes. And love always perseveres. Whether there be tongues, they will cease. Whether there be prophecies, they'll fail. Whether there be knowledge, it will vanish away. We know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, which is love, that which is done in part is done away. But when we're children, we spake as children. We reasoned as children. But when we become men, the mature state of the Spirit of God, we put away those childish things being tossed to and fro by every wind and doctrine and every sleight of man. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God. He that loveth not does not know God. Beloved, let us love one another. St. John chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. So the fruit of the Spirit of God, check it out, Galatians, the 5th chapter and the 22nd verse, is love, joy, peace. That's character as an inward state, not predicated upon anything external. If we are connected and submitted to the Holy Spirit, we'll have that constant presence of joy, that constant presence of peace that passes all human understanding. And we will have love. We will know whose we are and who we are, not predicated upon anything external. So we'll learn to be content in whatever state we find ourselves in, knowing that God is all-powerful, knowing that he knows the plan that he has for us, and it's to give us a hope, and it's to give us a future, and to bring us to an expected end, so we don't have to be anxious for anything. But with everything in prayer and supplication, we can make our requests made known to God, and he will give us a peace that passes human understanding. Love, joy, peace, character. And that's an expression toward our relationship. That's as an inward state. Then the overflow of that character and expression toward our own inward state as being yielded to the Holy Spirit will be long suffering or patience with our human relationships horizontally. Goodness, gentleness, these are three of the nine graces that make up character and expression toward our horizontal relationship with the human family and mankind. The overflow of that to be able to produce more fruit is faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Ephesians 6 goes on to tell us, above all, we've got to have the shield of faith that we can quench all those fiery darts that the enemy is hurling at us as the accuser of the brethren. We will be able to deflect them as we become fluent in being able to hold that shield of faith. That's above all, we have to have that shield of faith. We must believe that God is, and he's a rewarder of us who diligently seek him. And if he's for us, he's more than the world against us, and the gates of hell will not prevail against us. We'll be effective in being able to not just have that faith. That faith will move us as we exercise that faith muscle. We'll experience glory to glory, and God will give us supernatural power that we'll be able to use in meekness. That is one of the nine graces of the fruit of the Spirit of God. Galatians 6:1 says, we who are spiritual, when we see one overtaken in a fault, restore them in a spirit of meekness, considering ourselves, lest we also be tempted. The same spirit, we're competent, we're moved with compassion to comfort others. So that meekness, though he gives us supernatural power, we'll use that power to empower, and we'll have self control. Taken together, they make up the nine graces that make up the singular fruit of the Spirit of God, that people will know that we truly are connected to Christ. The fruit of the Spirit of God is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, and meekness, faith, and self-control. Taken together, they make a moral portrait of the no longer I, but Christ that now lives by faith in us. My time is gone. It's been a pleasure to be with you today. Thank you so much, Deliciously Free Me, Sister Pat, a.k.a. Deliciously Free Me, Pastor Marcia. God bless you, woman of God. Thank you for being with us. And hallelujah, amen, praise God. Thank you, our family at the Sealer Radio Ministry in New York, the Bronx, New York. Thank you, our family in Chicago, the Gospel Music and Productions Network. And thank our sister, Jennie Fournier. Thank you, Sister Patty Lee, for helping to facilitate, to advertise, and to have her be with us as our special guest addressing this issue of human trafficking. We're going to close out with some music by Shirley Murlock, and the song is entitled Lord, You Reign, as we shift to be able to go into the Mental Health in Your Neighborhood broadcast with Sister Louise Carcione, and Shedrick Garrett is her co-host every other week, and she'll be coming to you in just about 5 minutes. So keep it locked for Mental Health in Your Neighborhood. We love you. God bless you. And we, again, encourage you to partner with us with the opportunity to take over the airwaves. We still are looking for people to partner with us as Boston Praise Radio and TV Network has the opportunity to be on the air six nights a week. We've already lost one opportunity for one night because another entity took that night. So we've got yet the opportunity to take, I think, five nights. So we'll have six nights in total that will be on from 12 midnight till 6 a.m. on our AM station, giving us a further reach into these communities and the incarcerated and people who are in their cars. It's a AM secular 25,000 watt station. We need you to partner with us. And so you can go to www.bostonpraiseradio.tv to sow your seed, single time or ongoing. We're asking people to pay $200 for 4 months, I believe, and you will also be afforded airtime. But we need you to walk with us so that we can walk through this door. We need the provision for the vision that God's given us the opportunity to walk through. Won't you please partner with us? You can write a check or a money order and mail it to us at BostonPraiseRadio.tv is who you'll write the check out to. And you'll mail it to 670 Washington Street in Dorchester, Mass. 02122. If you want more information, please call us here live on the air, 617-282-0685, or call Pastor Bruce Wall. 670 Washington Street, Dorchester, Mass. 02124. Forgive me, you want to get it to the right zip code, 02124. Thank you, Louise Carcione. She's our treasurer over here helping me out. And you can also call the church at 617-282-7794. Or call 617-282-0685. That's the number for the radio station. Or call 617-283-9561. And if you want to call me, 617-594-9955. We'll help you get it, the resource to us. But we do need your help. Blessings to you. God bless you. We will see if God should say the same on tomorrow. Shirley Murnock with Lord, You Reign. Oh.